Welcome to another episode of White Paper Wednesdays, the show every Wednesday where I look through, a white paper of some kind or another, and I read through it and explain to you what it means. So this week it's going to be Hal Finney's Reusable Proof of Work, and this is an interesting paper from Hal Finney I think he sent straight to the Cypherpunks list in August of 2004. And based on this, Nick Szabo came up with BitGold, which we read through last week. But this one is Reusable Proofs of Work from Hal Finney. All right, so let's take a look at it. This link is available on the Satoshi Nakamoto Institute website, nakamotoinstitute.org/RPOW. It's also in the show notes. So anyway, all right, cypherpunks at alcata.net, kind of a hilarious, subject, reusable proof of work, RPOW, date. Sunday, August 15th, 2004. This is almost 16 years ago, which is kind of crazy. HalFinney.org. Hal Finney. I'd like to invite members of this list to try out my new Hashcash based server, RPOW.net. I don't know if I think they cached it right here at the Nakamoto Institute website, so you can take a look at what that looks like. This system receives hash cash as a proof of work token, and in exchange creates RSA signed tokens, which I call reusable proof of work tokens, RPOW tokens. RPOWs can then be transferred from person to person in exchange for new RPOWs at each step. Each RPOW or POW token can only be used once, since it gives birth to a new one. It is as though the same token can be handed from person to person. So if you don't know what proof of work is a way to, it's a hash that is lower than a certain number. It's fairly difficult to find unless you calculate lots of different hashes, and that's what proof of work is. What he's doing is it's a server that RSA signs these tokens, and now it can be transferred to someone. So the RPOW.net is essentially a central server or some sort of like notary saying, okay, yeah, that this is actually it. And then at each one, it can be transferred from person to person, presumably through some sort of signature, and then registered back at the central server, RPOW.net. Now, this is an interesting proposal, and he'll go on to explain it. Because RPOWs are only created from equal value POWs or RPOWs, they are as rare and valuable as the hash cash that was used to create them. But they are reusable, unlike hash cash. So it's reusable in the sense that, like, you could keep transferring it because there's a central authority that tells you what's going on. The new concept in the server is the security model. The RPOW server is running on a high security processor card, the IBM 4758 Secure Cryptographic Coprocessor, validated to FIPS 140 level 4. All right, so this might be a little bit of gobbledygook for you, but FIPS 140 certification, level 2 is tamper evident, so it's generally some sort of machine that you can tell whether or not the the machine has been tampered with, and maybe the private key kind of stolen out of it. So that's tamper evident is level 2. Level 3 is tamper proof. So if you try to break into the machine, what the machine does is it wipes all of the private key data material, so it can't be stolen. So it'll just reset to zero. It would rather lose it than have you be able to take it out. I think level 4 is something else, but it has all of the properties of level 3, so it's tamper proof. This card has the capability to deliver a signed attestation of the software configuration on the board, which any sufficiently motivated user can verify against the published source code of the system. So, this card is able to be to be verified, and you could take the code and see what it says and so on. This lets everyone see that the system has no backdoors and will only create RPOW tokens when supplied with the POW RPOW tokens of equal value. So in other words, it's a central notary or some sort of stamping service that is very open source in the spirit of you know, being transparent. I mean, still, you know, the fact that he's hosting it and stuff gives it all of the, you know, drawbacks of centralization. But you can see that Hal's trying to think through, you know, like, how do we mitigate some of that, right? Like, by creating this. This is what creates trust in RPOWs as actually embodying their claim values, the knowledge that they were in fact created based on an equal POW hash cash token. So after you certify that, it gives you an RSA certified, I guess, receipt or something that you can trade for other goods and services. So the idea is to have some sort of, you know, peer-to-peer cash or something without a central authority, but this kind of has a central authority. So it's not exactly cash in that sense. I have a lot more information about the system at rpow.net, along with the downloadable source code. There is a crude web interface which lets you exchange POWs for RPOWs without downloading the client. The system is in early beta right now, so I'd appreciate any feedback if anyone has a chance to try it out. Please keep in mind that if there are problems, I may need to reload the server code, which will invalidate any RPOW tokens which people have previously created. So don't go too crazy hoarding up RPOWs quite yet. Thanks very much. So this is an early version of trying to create some sort of a reusable proof of work, right? Like or some sort of a cash system based on proof of work, and the fact that it needs a central server like that you know, Hal Finney created. But here is the actual website that he created. So let's read through some of this. The RPOW system provides for proof of work tokens to be reused. A POW token is something that takes a relatively long time to compute, but which can be checked quickly. RPOW uses cash, which are values whose SHA-1 hashes have many high bits of zero. So this is pretty much from Adam Back's hashcash protocol. But it's using SHA-1. So Bitcoin uses SHA-256, which is in the family of SHA-2. So, you know, SHA-1 has more or less been broken by Google and so on. So you can't really use this anymore. But normally POW tokens can't be reused because that would allow them to be double spent. So if I gave you a POW token, if I did a certain amount of work and gave you that, I can also give it to someone else because I have the exact copy of the same thing. But RPOW allows for a limited form of reuse, sequential reuse. This lets a POW token be used once, then exchanged for a new one, which can again be used once, then once more exchanged, etc. This approach makes POW tokens more practical for many purposes and allows the effective cost of a POW token to be raised while still allowing systems to use them effectively. So essentially, there's a central registry that certifies that it's been transferred to somebody and so on. So that's how it gets to making it solving the double spend problem, but it still requires something centralized. Security. This is useful functionality, but the unique feature of the RPOW system is its approach to security. RPOW is the first public implementation of a server design to allow users throughout the world to verify its correctness and integrity in real time. Based on principles similar to those proposed for so-called trusted computing, RPOW allows third parties to dynamically and remotely verify what program is running on the RPOW server. The RPOW server is implemented on a high-quality secure processor, the IBM 475658 PCI cryptographic coprocessor, which has been validated to the highest level of security publicly available, FIPS 140 Level 4. The 4758 is a self-contained single-board computer which has its own device key generated on board and never leaves the card. That key can issue cryptographically signed attestations which describe the software configuration running on the card, including SHA-1 hash of the application program. The source code to the RPOW server is available from the download page. Using publicly available tools, anyone can build from the source code a memory image identical to that running on the RPOW server. The SHA-1 hash of this file matches that being reported by the 4758 device key, the user can conclude that the supplied source code is what is actually running on the 4758. By inspecting the source code, he can then make sure there are no backdoors or loopholes that would allow the owner, operator, or designer of the system to defeat its security, for example, by creating RPOW tokens without doing the required work. Allowing clients to dynamically validate the security of a server turns the concept of trusted computing on its head. Rather than a threat to individual privacy, the technology becomes a boon to privacy and an empowering force for end users on the net. So his vision was that this is open source, validatable. I think FIPS level 4 means that, you know, it can attest to what is actually running on the card and so on. But but that again is a central authority that determines that whether it's a FIPS 140 level 4. You can examine the source code. He's trying to make it as open as possible so the centralized server doesn't have that much power. Security researcher Nick Szabo has coined the term bit gold for information objects which are provably costly to create. He suggests that these could even serve as a foundation of some sort of payment system playing the role in the informational world of gold in the physical world. A reusable proof of work would facilitate the use of proof of work tokens as a form of bit gold by allowing the tokens to be passed and exchanged from person to person. POW tokens have been proposed as a form of pseudo payment in several applications. One example is email. An email message containing a POW token would be relatively costly to send in terms of computing power. A POW token could then be a sign that the message was not spam. Using the RPOW tokens for email would have advantages as people could then reuse tokens from incoming email and outgoing email. Spammers will have no such advantages since almost all of their email is outgoing. Reuse allows the cost of the POW token to be much higher since people won't have to generate them, making the system more effective as an anti-spam measure. So, how I obviously knew about Nick Szabo's BitGold, and it's trying to create some sort of monetary system and price mechanisms using something that is known to be costly, and that's the idea here that Satoshi Nakamoto took, and added difficulty adjustments and blocks and everything like that to make that work. But right now, this is a centralized version of that. To be quite frank, this is probably better than most altcoins that are out there, because it would be a lot faster for one, because the signatures can be done on a server much quicker. A computer is a lot more trustworthy than like a founder or developer team. That's what Hal Finney did was with this secure processor and so on. Transparent servers. The reusable proof-of-work system is just the first of what are planned as a series of systems which use this approach, which I call transparent servers. Such systems publish their source code for review and inspection and use trusted computing-like features to prove that they are running the program generated by that code. This will provide an unprecedented level of transparency and visibility into the workings of network servers. Of course, Bitcoin does a step better, because you're running your own node, you're running your own code, and instead of trusted computing, you're trusting nobody, you're trusting the code that you're running yourself, and you don't have to trust that the code running on some other server is what it says it is. Perhaps most importantly, the use of the transparency can actually increase end user privacy. For the first time, users will be able to verify how network servers will handle sensitive information they provide. In the case of a reusable proof-of-work server, users can see that the program makes no record of transactions and creates no linkage between reusable proof-of-work issued on one exchange with the same reusable proof-of-work when it is later deposited, thereby protecting privacy. In addition, the basic security goal of the system that it will never reissue reusable proof of works without receiving a POW or RPOW of equal value can be independently verified. Not even the owner of the RPOW server can break these rules. For more information on the techniques used to provide these new and previously unavailable assurances, see the security page. So, really, really cool that we can you know, that he came up with this back in 2004. Nick Szabo wrote that thing in 2005, and they were playing with this. And it's probably from this that, you know, Satoshi Nakamoto gained a lot of the ideas and came up with Bitcoin. It has a lot of intellectual predecessors. This is a centralized form, obviously. But, you know, like, it's trying to be transparent. It's trying to be done in a way so that you know, people can still verify things. You know, it requires some trusted computing and so on. But it's a lot better than a lot of the altcoins that that existed. So anyway, that is it for reusable proof of work. I mean, I guess we can read through some of this other ones or theory or the security. I don't think we need to go through much of it. I think I've more or less described it. So anyway, I don't see any other questions, but yeah, this was a fairly quick read. Hopefully that made sense, and it gives you an idea of the history of Bitcoin and gives you an appreciation for Hal Finney's contribution to this space. May he rest in peace. Fiat delenda est, this song is done.